calling all my freaks and geeks. This is the Square Roundtable Podcast. Thank you all for coming out today. And I am your host, Chad Singleton, and these are my wonderful co-hosts. Go ahead and introduce yourselves, guys.
Hey, I'm Josh Singleton.
I'm Marcus, Mark and Mark.
All right, guys. And we have a very special guest with us today. Our guest is an award-winning filmmaker, animator, and the owner of the London and California-based animation studio, Studio Linguini. So everybody give it up for Mr. Nick Cinelli. How are you doing, sir?
Pretty good. Thanks for having me on, guys. Pretty good.
Definitely. Yeah. Yeah. No, it's a pleasure because especially like I know my brother, he's huge on stop motion, so he was like incredibly excited when I told him that he wanted to come on our show.
Yeah, do a little something.
But definitely but yeah, we're so happy to have you. But yeah, I kind of wanted to get a little background about you because I know, of course, like your Studio Linguini, like specializes in 2D, 3D animation and stop motion. But I wanted to know in general, like what led you to wanting to have a career as an artist? And did you have any early influences? Like anybody you looked up to?
For me, probably the biggest thing was autonomy. You know, you either it's egotistical or, you know, you just have a kind of hard time taking direction. I think that was a little bit of it that kind of pushed me into working individually a little bit more. You know, of course, I love collaborating with people. But then sometimes you think like, I don't want to be told what to do. And I think that kind of pushed me a little bit out of the film industry, which is where I was working for a while, kind of between like 2012 and 2016, 2017. I got a little bit kind of tired of getting kind of treated like a sheep in a flock and herded around, you know, rather than actually, you know, being listened to and kind of having my opinion valued. I started kind of just doing my own stuff because it was a little bit more fulfilling and, you know, rewarding time-wise, you know, like actually investing in something that I could see the return on and feel proud of. So I slowly kind of shifted away from working in films into kind of doing my own film projects. And then I think really kind of everything clicked with specifically stop motion animation because it put together a bunch of the things that I'd, you know, studied in school and I'd worked and learned on film sets. And I was just kind of interested in, as a kid, like you're asking, you know, and so that was kind of the culmination of a bunch of skills that I'd, and interests that I'd kind of, you know, unknowingly put together. So then in about 2017 or so, I really kind of like dived into animation specifically and leaned into that and kind of away from other things and kind of, you know, it took a while to build the confidence of thinking of myself as a director, you know, or someone who could actually like could do that because I, you know, was used to not being that person, being a person who does a job and then leaves. And so it took a little bit of time to kind of be comfortable. And I'm still, you know, in the midst of that, you know, even being on a podcast, it's like, okay, I don't know why you guys want to know from me, you know, but like, I'll do my best. And so it's, I don't know, it's, I guess it's kind of, you know, just me forcing myself to do my thing and knowing that I am interested in kind of exploring that. And, you know, so far so good that obviously people have been interested enough that it has continued. And I guess as far as some of the earlier kind of influences, you know, I growing up, I watched mostly like the independent film channel. If you guys like remember that, it still exists, you know. But I had like a TV in my room when I was a kid, and I never really like got into the daytime television when like Survivor was on and like all those kind of things, you know, in the 90s and stuff. And I was just like, I don't know, my parents, you know, my mom was upstairs, you know, watching TV and my brother and sister and stuff, and you know, sometimes at school, but I was kind of more interested in watching like the independent film channel and just things that were like weird and foreign and you know, like a lot of David Cronenberg kind of stuff, which is like weird body horror, you know, like that, yeah, or like some, you know, some of these old like Prometheus and Bob was like a big weird stop motion thing that I was into.
I love
it. I remember that. I remember that.
100%. Like, just like weird shit, you know? And I was just like, okay, maybe I should get into that, you know? And so then kind of, you know, along with what I was saying, the timeline of, you know, kind of after working in the film industry for a while, I was like, maybe I'm just going to go into that. Like, you know, it existed before. Why can't it exist again? And actually in doing that, I've kind of tapped into a bigger world of animation that is exactly kind of where I was hoping to get into. So, you know, hopefully that's a helpful answer.
No, it certainly is.
It's good.
Definitely. Just knowing that we have like a similar, well, just I've had similar experience, like, well, watching like Prometheus and Bob, like that sort of thing. Yeah. Like that was huge for, like, you know, because we're all like, what, like 90s babies, so we're all old. So like that's
kind of stuff. Hey, speak for yourself. I'm not old.
You said I'm young at heart.
Right. I'm throwing everybody under the bus.
Just because you feel old. But,
yeah. I mean, and I mean that, like Star Wars for sure, you know, was like a massive influence. I was not like a Lord of the Rings kind of kid.
Okay.
Yeah. I was for sure a Star Wars kind of kid, you know, and got like into the fucking Legos and kind of like paraphernalia around it and the world building. And I think actually like things like that and Prometheus and Bob and, you know, a lot of these kind of David Cronenberg things that I was really into was really about like building a whole world of something rather than watching some kind of drama or some kind of reality show or something that's kind of a mirror of reality, creating something that's completely different, I think was really what was kind of inspiring and pushed me to kind of get into that kind of, you know, creative sensibility.
Prometheus and Bob was wild, man. I used
it was fucking
to
wild,
it.
Right?
I used to love it. Yeah. I was way up just to watch it.
Because like you're looking for all that like different stuff, like you're not looking for all that like daytime TV or stuff, you're looking for that stuff that's like different than that, like that makes you go, that's weird but I like it.
But I like it is essential, because sometimes it's like that's weird and
I wasn't into that,
you know.
But there's so much of that though. There's so much of like everything is just like, if it's not reality TV or like you said with a Survivor, game show this, game show that. So just to have something there that's, you know, just noticeably maybe a little jarring, you know, it's aesthetically pleasing, just something that's just different, you know, like that's just the best. Like,
yeah,
I definitely agree. But yeah. But so how did you get from point A to point B? Because you were talking about some of your influences. As far as being a director and being an artist, what made you specifically want, and what was the process, period? Because stop motion looks so hard. So what made you want to build and make something that's literally tangible? Like your stop motion puppets, you can pick them up and move them. It's not just pen to paper. Like what made you fall in love with that medium, like in general?
Yeah, I guess. I think I'm like really a tactile person. Like I'm, for the past, you know, 2 weeks we've been in the studio just building different sets and using power tools and like, you know, different saws and screw guns. And we just got a battery powered brad nailer, you know, which is like a ridiculous tool that nobody cares about, but I like to geek out on that kind of thing for whatever. Like, you know, go to Home Depot and spend like an hour just looking at the tools aisle because of, you know, for me, it's like really a whole world of potential, you know, it's like, oh, if I have this tool, I can do this thing. And I think that's kind of been a thing that's been in my, you know, wiring for like a long time. I remember playing with those like Tetris blocks as a kid, or like the Rubik's Cube blocks, but not the one that you turn, the one that you have to build. If you remember.
I remember that.
Or like those little, like, you know, the things where you like have to unhook the nails from each other, like those kind of things. I was like always really into those, or like Kinects and Legos and, you know, Erector Set and like all that kind of stuff, like was what I was as a kid. You know, I just would like shut up and be in the corner and like play with Legos for hours on end, you know. And like, and I think that for a while you don't realize how much that those kind of things are, like what it is, I guess, when you're a kid, is going to influence you and manifest later and actually like who you are as an adult. And looking back, of course, like those are, you know, incredibly formative. And then, you know, I went through my pubescence and adult and, you know, early adulthood and teenage years or whatever, and like tried to figure myself out. And then you kind of fall back on what you know. And I have always kind of known this whatever, you know, physicality of objects and things. And so I think like that understanding of 3D space, the kind of puppetry, the using, you know, tools is essentially like just the adult version of what I was doing as a kid. You know, and I think it's that kind of just way of thinking about, you know, I don't know, space and geometry and things that are kind of just the way that I work. And I'm as well, you know, really interested in it. And as well, I can't really draw, you know, so like draw an animation without the window. I mean, I can draw enough to explain what's happening in a room, but like you look at it and you'd be like, wow, you know, I don't know if it's going to be your career path again,
you know? Like, I think you need to start something else.
Yeah. This might not be where you want to go, dude. That,
you know?
Right. But yeah, cool so story,
think,
bro.
Yeah, so I think it's really like the stick and the carrot, you know, where it's like, I have to go over there because I can't do the other, but as well, like, I'm enticed to go over there, you know, which is like the physical kind of world building. That being said, you know, there's a reason that I work with a bunch of collaborators is because they're all better than me at doing those things. So I'm at like an interesting point right now where, you know, for it's been like 3 or 4 years where I've built up an understanding of how these, you know, practical stop motion worlds work. You know, like I know how the carpentry works. I know how the puppets need to be built, how the, you know, the skeleton that's inside them, you know, needs to be worked, and what materials kind of will work as skin, and how to cure those materials like silicone and latex, and like all the kind of fine detail things that, you know, some people care about, some people don't. I do, you know, and so I got really invested in those kind of fine details in certain categories. And now I'm getting to the point where I'm like, okay, you know, I understand the lighting, I understand the carpentry, I understand the kind of art and whatever, but it's taking a step back from that and then looking at like a project as a whole, you know, which is like the directing part that I was kind of talking about earlier, you know, is a weird thing because I'm removing myself actually from touching and making and like doing the process itself. And so for me, that's kind of where I'm at right now is the balancing act of like how to do that and maintain interest and best kind of utilize my skill set, but as well get the best product, because, you know, it's been many projects since I actually made the puppets, because that make them so much better than me, you know? And so what am I doing if I'm making something that I could have, you know, someone do better? Or same thing now with sets and things like that, where it's, you know, there, when you get into it, there are really, really, really niche specific skills that someone will have, you know, like I'm working with a woman now who's over in Northern England, and she's making puppets for an upcoming project, and she's really good, and she's working at like the best puppet company in the world right now, and doing my project as a side job just because, you know, we're friends. And what she does for her regular job is focus on painting the eyes of puppets, you know, for a bigger production. And that's her specific job, is like the painting of the eyes, both that and then the sewing of the shoes, you know? And so you're like, okay, she's honed in on that. And then she works with someone who works on the mechanics of like the facial mechanism, like how the jaw works and how the eyes and nose move in a puppet, you know? And so not only is it just one person making a puppet or like a group of 2 or 3 people, but it's like a whole team of 30 people and a lot of science and a lot of engineering and a lot of, you know, massive amounts of skill that are going into one of these puppets.
That's awesome.
And then the director is even further removed, and there's like 3 steps between director and actual like touching of the puppet. And so it's, you know, it's wild to see that is where you could go to, not to say that I will get to that kind of scale of production, but that, like, you know, you can really break something down into such minute detail that there will be someone who is the best at doing the smallest, most obscure skill, you know? And I think, I don't know where I was exactly going with that, but with that kind of in mind, it's like, okay, you know, there's no use in me trying to do everything, because there's so many people that will do whatever it is, specifically much better, you know? And that's kind of, yeah, that's kind of where I'm at.
But yeah, Nick, it's interesting how you talk about the intricacies of the puppets. And I saw on your Instagram how there was like a mouth chart for the Ed Balloon puppet. Like, yeah. Did you make all those mouths and put all like the vowels? I saw it was like the vowels on the bottom of the mouth. Like, did you make all those?
Yeah. So the Ed Balloon puppet is great because that was the first puppet where we actually built a puppet based on an actual living dude, you know,
wow.
Like the guy, the human exists. And so we want to make the puppet look like the human, but not in a weird kind of way. Like the eyes themselves mm-hmm. are like, look like puppet eyes on purpose, you know, so to not get this kind of uncanny feeling.
Yeah.
yeah. So, you know, cause like sometimes it gets like when you, it's like a bad tattoo, you know, where you like try to do a portrait of someone, but it doesn't come out like them and it looks kind of weird. And that's kind of the same thing with puppets.
It could be kind of off-putting a little bit.
Yeah,
too.
It looks a little jarring. You're just like, it looks a little weird.
So we decided. So we leaned into like the puppet feeling of like making it for sure a puppet, even though it actually is Ed. And when it came to knowing that puppet specifically, like, you know, working with Ed, he is a super gung-ho kind of dude who's a go-getter and kind of, you know, a little bit here, a little bit there, just trying to, you know, do what we're all trying to do is, you know, make the best stuff possible. But he wasn't exactly sure as to what he wanted to do, if it was a music video or a bunch of skits or whatnot. And so with that in mind, we kind of made an all-around puppet that had like a pretty solid armature, you know, like build in him so the body could do whatever. And then we made a bunch of like hand replacements and things. And to get to the mouths, what we wanted to be able to do with the mouths was make sure that he could both sing and talk, because we knew that those were things that we were going to want this puppet to be able to do. So to be able to specifically talk, like you can look at my mouth right now and it's moving in an array of shapes,
mm-hmm.
which is different than if I was to be like just smiling or frowning, like or you know. Mm-hmm. Often we can get away with like five or six mouth shapes to just express emotion, but when it comes to actually like mimicking sound or like syncing it to his song, you know, or make it look like he's actually singing, you need to have certain vowel shapes and like, you know, consonant shapes and whatever kind of combined different things to actually allow yourself the freedom to make the puppet talk as if it were a human, you know? So knowing that we needed to do that, we made, I think it was like 18 different shapes, which are kind of standard shapes. You know, once you've kind of hit the whole alphabet in English, there's a basic number of shapes that you need to have. So we follow those, and the guy who actually made the puppet, this dude Harry, is over in Bristol in England. And he worked with Ed, and actually was a fan, surprisingly, of Ed before making the puppet of him, which I, you know, just a small world, I guess. And so was really excited about it, and, you know, and sculpted everything, and I guess to not bore you guys, but to go into even more detail, like, the head itself. Let me see if I have it, actually. I can show you.
Yes, please. Hey, that'd be amazing.
That'd be awful.
Yes.
So, like...
Oh, awesome.
Like, you know, so this is Ed, and so you can't tell if my camera is good enough for you guys to see it, but like they're like the eyebrows and the eyes themselves are just pieces of like, it's like clay that when you bake it hardens, you know. Okay. It's called and so those are like little things that were shaped and baked, and then they're stuck onto the face itself with like a little bit of wax, and then you can move them, you know, like the eyebrows and the eyes, like with a toothpick or something to give it expression over time. And then the mouth, you know, you saw all the bits, it pops off, you know, so you can see here that there's like a slot.
Oh.
And then here's the slot, and this says BMP, you know, so it's like a kind of mouth shape.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, and so
that's really cool.
Yeah, and then each one has exactly the same kind of shape back there, so that when you slot it in, it'll align with the previous shape, and then when it moves in motion, it looks like he's talking.
Oh.
And those, and all of these little mouths were all hand carved and hand painted by that dude, Harry. And they're made out of like the same kind of like clay and, you know, sculpt and shape. And then you put it in the oven or whatever, and then it hardens it. So that's kind of how it was made. Yeah.
That's awesome, man.
That's cool. That's really cool.
No, I mean, it's a lot of work. That's pretty cool.
Yeah. But the thing with this one, you know, with Ed, is that we kind of made it well and durably because, like I was saying, we haven't really planned all the things that we were going to do. And so Ed was just like, I just want a puppet. And we were like, okay, cool. And then got him a puppet. And now the puppet exists and the potential is kind of endless with it, you know?
Yeah.
So
that was the game plan.
So no, yeah. Oh, go ahead, Demetrius.
I was gonna ask you, like, how long did it take you from like to go from the start of a production of like any kind of like animation you put out to like finishing? How long did that process take?
It depends on a lot of things. It depends on, I guess, like the main ones are budget, quality, and you know, like necessary time, like what the allotted schedule is. You know, and you balance all three of those accordingly. So something like a music video can be anywhere from like 2 months is probably the fastest. Oh, wow. For like 3 minutes. And that's a crazy haul, you know, to do something like that. Up until like 4 or 5 months, you know, is as well, you know, kind of the longer end. So I'd say between 2 and 5 for like a 2 to 3, you know, somewhere in a 3 minute music video range. When it comes to actually like animating the puppet that's like set in a set or on a stage or whatever, you could kind of average out about 10 seconds per day of like single puppet animation time.
Okay.
You know, if you have like 6 puppets in a scene, you know, and a camera that's moving and some kind of crazier shot, it's harder to do that much, you know. But if the puppet's just like standing there gesturing, you know, 10, even up to 15 seconds in a day is possible. But that's just the animation. Obviously, all like the build time that goes into that is as well, you know, is a thing. The way that I guess might make sense is that you know, if you think about 2D animation where you just have a pen and paper, right, and then you just start drawing something and you draw it and draw it and draw it and draw it and draw it.
Yeah,
you can start doing the finished product essentially right away. Like, there's no barrier to entry on the animation, and then you go back into it and you adjust it, and slowly, like, you start building this thing. But with stop motion, and it's very slow. Like, 2D animation is probably like 2 to 3 seconds a day of animation time, but you can start right away. But with stop motion, you have to like build the sets, you have to build the puppets, you have to, you know, get all the lights in order. You have to, once all those are done, then you put it all together, and then you get the lights set, and you have to have blocked out the shot that you're doing. So there's a lot of like prep and prep and prep and prep and prep. And then once you're good to go, then you start animating, you know, and it's actually much faster to animate than something like 2D. So it's a different kind of way of weighing the scales, I guess.
Okay. As far as
the process goes. Huh. Yeah.
So basically, stop motion needs more prep work. Basically.
Yeah. It's all prep, and then you can kind of punch through animation pretty quickly versus something like 2D where it's just more evenly spread out across time.
Yeah.
And that's a lot of time to dedicate to like animation and the prep work and all that stuff. So, like, if you ever mess up, then it's just like,
Yeah. I mean, it's it's the most devastating when you're like, the thing with 2D is that you mess up a line, you can just erase it, you know, or you like throw away that page and come back, or you erase it on Photoshop or whatever you're doing. But the problem with stop motion is you can't do that as easily. So like, you could be spending, I don't know, a day and a half, 2 days I've spent on some shots before, and then you're tired and you're whatever, you know, not paying attention, and then you bump the table, you kick the camera or something.
No,
you know, and the whole thing is just ruined, and that is a feeling.
Oh, gosh.
That's a feeling that every stop motion animator has gone through, and you're just like, oh man, it's like getting kicked in the nuts four times right in a row. You're like, nothing you can do about it. It just hurts and it hurts and it hurts. And then you gotta, like, you know, pick up pieces and then carry on, you know.
Just gotta start over,
you know.
Just gotta just do it again.
Exactly. And then you like another day and a half of wait time. It really makes you think differently about time, I guess, is the deal. You know, a working day is 8 hours. A flight to London is like, you know, 10 hours. Driving across the country is like 48 hours. And you're like, okay, what actually does that mean in terms of animation time? You know, like I could enter the studio, work for 12 hours and come out with about like 6 seconds of animation, or I could go to London. And you're like, well, at that point, what the fuck is an hour? What, you know, who does it matter? You know, just right. what you're engaging in doing, you know, if that makes sense.
Yeah, 100%.
It definitely does. But yeah, how long did the Ghost Main video take? Like, what was the process of that?
Yeah.
That one had a bigger budget, so we were able to kind of crank through it pretty fast. And it was only one puppet. So I think it was about two and a half, 3 weeks maybe of like preparation time.
Where okay.
Well, you know, of like preparation time, doing all the kind of set designs, drawing out the animatic of what we were going to do, you know, working with Eric on like how the whole thing was going to look, you know, getting the whole thing kind of good to go. And then it was about a month of, you know, 3.5-4 weeks of building, you know, like making the puppet, making the set, getting all the lights in order, getting the studio kind of good to go, and then getting a 2D animation house on board, you know, so they were working simultaneously with us as, as we were kind of going, so we could have two engines basically spinning at the same time. And then it was about a month of animation, so I guess it would be two full months plus 3 weeks about to do that.
Okay.
Is about how long the entirety of it took, but we had, you know, obviously two different, you know, the guys, they were in Colombia, the guys who were doing the 2D. So I never actually met them except on Zoom like this. We just sent them all our stuff and they were working on it and we were kind of regularly collaborating on that, but had, you know, we were able to double the turnout because there was half animation per team. You know.
Yeah, I love that video.
I was like, man, that was so cool. Like that, it was like that 1930s, like Disney, Steamboat Willie, like kind of style with a little bit of like Tim Burton, like Frankenweenie with the black and white. Just watching that, and then Bird with No Legs, especially from like a film perspective, and just like the aesthetics of what, like, you accomplished with it was so beautiful, because even to how, you know, you use like a blue to, for, I guess it was the father, you use like him as blue and the son was like normal, you know, his normal complexion. Mm. And, you know, blue is always, you know, considered to be like, you know, sad color or show cold or, you know, death and stuff like that. And you use the warm colors to show the life. And it was just awesome how you use that. And even, I don't know if you guys seen it, but I always talk about like German expressionism, because, you know, they teach you that like in film. And I've seen like a lot of that with some of the shapes and stuff you use. And I know for me, I was introduced to that before I even knew what it was, because I used to love Tim Burton films when I was younger.
Yeah.
So to see that and see what you was doing, it was like, man, that's awesome. Like, I enjoyed like every little thing you was putting in there. Like I was film geeking out the whole time I was
watching. Yeah. I mean, that's like spot on what we were kind of going for. It was like a German impressionist world with kind of Tim Burton feeling, and then the, you know, referencing like the Fleischer brothers, like the old Betty Boop kind of animated.
Yeah.
Really kind of shoving it all together in like a metal, a rap metal genre.
You know, the song was crazy.
Yeah, the song was crazy.
It all kind of comes together in like a weird, you know, salad or something like that. A bunch of different ingredients, you know.
Yeah.
And I just love the... Oh, go ahead, Josh. My bad.
Hey, also, Nick, I saw in the Ghost Main video how the cartoon was holding the puppet. And
I was just about to say that.
And in the Bird With No Legs video, how the dad was falling. Like, how are you able to capture levitation and gravity in your stop motion?
Yeah, that, I mean, it's essentially how you would do it in a live action as well. On a green screen, or like with a kind of erasing certain bits in post or compositing. But what you do is you take the puppet and then you rig, there's like a point back on the back of the sternum or in the front or like the back of the chest, something like that. And you have like a bit that acts as kind of like a rigging point. And then you can animate that. And so what I did with the puppet in the AI video was like just animate him as if and pretending like something was carrying him, knowing that that would get filled in later. But it was like a weird kind of like, it looks like an elephant snout or something like that, that you just animate and then make him like levitate through the air. And then you pretend like gravity exists and make it like bounce as if he was walking. You know,
that's pretty cool.
And then the same thing of him falling into the bird with no legs, into the hole. You know, you just put a green screen down there and then send him, you know, just all the way down.
Which was a beautiful sequence, by the way. I love that. Sure, I love that sequence.
Thanks.
But yeah, one thing I was that I really liked about A Bird With No Legs is how like it was musically driven. And it wasn't too much dialogue besides, you know, singing the wife singing the title song. And I just wanted to know, like, what made you want to just have music sort of and the visuals tell the story rather than just straight dialogue back and forth?
I think I'm close friends with the guy who was the composer of that film, who I knew I was going to work with before we even kind of started shooting it. And so we kind of had thought about doing a musical just because, you know, it's kind of fun. And that was made, you know, at my grad school. And so I was like, I think, you know, if there's an opportunity to kind of do a musical, which I'm not really into, and I don't know why I did it, but it was kind of just a fun thing that we thought was a cool way of exploring, to really like explore a bunch of the themes that we wanted to explore. You know, I guess it's a whole kind of thing, but like we wanted to get at jazz because jazz is like this kind of conversation of instruments. You know, it's like a cacophony of kind of people talking sometimes over each other, sometimes in unison with each other, and that's what makes jazz super interesting. And that was the kind of impetus of doing the musical, is like actually using that as the way of having a father and son communicate with each other. Because like, you know, I'm sure you guys all, you know, have or have had, you know, dads and myself included who, you know, are not necessarily the best at communicating, especially like a father-son kind of relationship is like a thing to negotiate. And everybody, you know, every son has their own unique one, but
for sure.
But there's a kind of tension there or some kind of like grinding of gears. And so we wanted to kind of address that in a way that was kind of a little bit more fun and lighthearted, and it would be, you know, not necessarily so melodramatic, but, you know, a way that maybe would make sense to people, which is kind of how it made sense to me and Tom, the composer, you know, where you can't necessarily express yourself with words, but like an action or a kind of, you know, collaboration through music or some other kind of thing that breaks through and works in the place of actually communicating with words. But it's accomplishing the same thing. Was really kind of what we were getting at. And so kind of a combination of jazz being able to do that, and then the relationship between the father and the son, and you know, interest in musicals that kind of led to that whole, you know, thing.
Wow, And you were, so you were actually in grad school at the time. You were attending.
Yeah, that was, that was the school. Cool. That was a project made at school. Yeah.
Cool.
Wow.
So I know it must have felt crazy to get an award for your, you know, something you did in grad school.
I know, right?
Yeah. I know it must have been crazy.
Yeah. I mean, like, it's cool, but also, you know, like, the, it's interesting because in school, you're so inundated with what you're doing. You know, you're like, sure. I'm in grad school for the purpose of doing this, and this is my whole thing, and I don't have the responsibilities of, like, real life, you know, because I'm fully invested in school. And so then it feels like a weird, you know, time that, like, you know, for me, where I knew that, you know, if I was trying to focus on animation while working in LA, you know, and, or trying to make it, you know, without experience, like it wasn't working. That's why I like set aside 3 years of time to do that. And then while you're there, you're inundated and you're like, okay, cool. You know, I like, and then you get an award for it and you're like, it is kind of validating, but then you're like, but actually what I want is a job, you know, in animation and like be able to do this regularly. And so for me, the award is cool, but then the fact that now like it's kind of spurred more into like a regular career is what is even more rewarding. And so what I kind of laugh about is like, what would be even cooler is if I get an award on like one of the next projects that I work on, you know, or a short film that I work on as like a working professional, because that I think would feel like a stamp of progression, you know?
Mm-hmm. I understand, definitely.
Where it's like, okay, that was like the springboard, but now actually it's kind of, it's turned into, you know, a proper moving forward in a career. That, I think that would be awesome.
Okay.
Yeah.
Definitely.
But I realized that you also did Broken Dream, and what I found interesting about Broken Dream is how the faces were drawn. Like, how was that process? Like, how were you able to do that?
That's something that I did that at school as well. Wow. I did that in like the first year, and then the, you know, second and a half year was A Bird with No Legs. But that was kind of just like an experiment. That I thought was, you know, it was cool and I wanted to try it. And, you know, like, I guess now that I've kind of explained how that Ed Balloon puppet works, like, you can see how it could be difficult to change that many facial features, like eyes and eyebrows and mouth shapes and things like that.
Right.
It becomes a very, like, complicated way of animating and it slows you down a little bit. And so, specifically with that project, I took away all of the facial animation, and then you can just focus on like body movements and things like that, and then go back in afterwards and really kind of fine tune it. And that was the first time that I'd done anything like that. And it was, you know, interesting. I worked with some friends and I think it has its, you know, pluses and minuses. But yeah, it was like, you know, you go through everything and then you go back into every frame and draw the face on in like a 2D animation style. And I think I would probably try to do it again, something like that. But I think more importantly, it kind of, you know, spurred an interest in, mixing 2D and stop motion, you know, visual forms. Cause I think it's a cool way of, you know, I guess just like geeking out on the possibilities of animation. It's like, what if we put this thing here and this thing here? And then, you know, you know? So I guess you could, like, Broken Dreams was the first attempt at a process like that. And then with the Ghost Main video, it was like a furthering, you know, of like taking those genres and putting them together. And I think, you know, we do have a couple more projects that are in the works that are that same kind of thing. I just think I have an interest in mixing those genres.
Well, we certainly can't wait to see them.
Yes. Yeah, yes. Most definitely.
Yeah,
can't wait. Yeah. Keep a lookout for it.
100%. Nick, a question I have is, you know, like, because of now where you're at, as far as like doing like stop motion animation, and just going to, like, because I'm pretty much sure you've seen, you know, The Nightmare Before Christmas, and just looking at something like that when you were younger, and then, like, now you're doing that, like, you know, how does, like, that kind of feel? Like, now I'm actually working on stuff like that, and I've seen something like that, not knowing, you know, I will end up actually doing things like that.
I think it's exciting. I think, like, Nightmare Before Christmas and Corpse Bride and, you know, like, even, like, Coraline and James and the Giant Peach and, like, all these old kind of stuff.
I love James and the Giant Peach.
Yeah, like, those are like, I guess, you know, I don't know, like, it's like a second wave of animation that Tim Burton kind of brought in, and then Leica kind of came around to, and, you know, there's been I think that maybe kickstarted a resurgence of it or something. You know, I'm not the best at kind of, you know, I guess film history or stop motion history, but those kind of things are what, like, all of my peer group of animators looked to as, like, the kind of old guard of animation. You know, like, I've met a couple guys who animated on, you know, on those films, like, here in LA. They're, you know, they're around, the guys who did that, and they're 25 years older than me, 25 years older, because, like, that's what they were doing when they were, you know, kind of up and coming animators, and the world was smaller, and you know, it was kind of just this, like, niche thing. And that obviously, like, branched out into all of us kids now who are, like, you know, doing our styles of animation. And I think, you know, in a similar way that, like, the 5D kind of made filmmaking at a high quality available to anybody who, you know, who could get access to a 5D, which is much easier than a big kind of cinema camera. I think it's a similar kind of thing with stop motion right now, where it's like, you know, the Dragon Frame program, which is the, you know, the status quo of doing animation. I think it's like $200 or something like that. You know, so it's not very much as far as any of these, like, programs go. And then you can hook it up to your iPhone or your GoPro or, like, anything, you know, like, either, like, it hooks up to most cameras that have existed for the past 15 years, you know? So with, like, between $200 and, you know, $400 overhead, you can make something that can compete, you know, not necessarily in quality, but, like, if you put enough effort into it, you can make super, super, super cool things without the kind of massive production. And I think that kind of, you know, understanding and, you know, kind of younger kids that have a wherewithal to, like, use cameras and, you know, natively can pick up this stuff a bit better and now have access to it, I think is leading to a lot more people doing animation. And so I think, you know, for me, it's incredibly exciting to be one of those people that's, you know, trying to build and you know, there's a lot of us. But I also think, like, it'll be interesting to see, you know, in, like, 10 years, what actually comes to the surface of, like, you know, the big brand things that people will remember. You know, like, I remember certain, you know, music videos that I'd seen, you know, from
like Sledgehammer.
Yeah, like that, or, like, you know, even later, like, you know, there's certain things that kind of, like, puncture the memory of either music videos or films or things like that, you know, in a kind of wider scale that influence the next iteration of animators. And so, you know, I'm just, I guess, excited to see what all that will kind of turn, will start turning into, because it's a pretty straight line from, you know, Coraline and Corpse Bride and, you know, Nightmare Before Christmas to every single person who's doing stop motion animation now. You know, like, not a single stop motion animator hasn't seen Nightmare Before Christmas. And so it's like, what is the progression, you know, next? Because that obviously was, like, the godfather of a lot
for
of
sure.
And so it's like, you know, I would love to have one of those projects that people reference in 10 years being like, oh, shit, like, that was the thing, you know?
Definitely.
Even in a small scale, you know, like someone sees a music video and like, that's what got me into it, you know, and, mm-hmm. and like, that's kind of all you want, I guess, out of the art form.
This would be like an inspiration to someone else.
Yeah. You know, even, just, you know, cause obviously it's nice to get praise from people that like the work, and it's nice to get another job from the job that you finish, you know, and kind of keep the employment happening. But as well to like, you know, actually make someone decide that they want to do animation or like really get invested in it, I think is like the coolest thing, because, you know, there's a reason that I'm so emotionally invested in stop motion that I think it, you know, it has an appeal to people that I would like to share, you know.
Definitely.
100%. And I'll be honest, like even... because like you said, now a lot of stuff that wasn't out back then when, you know, you had your Nightmare Before Christmas and even, you know, some of the older stuff like Wallace and Gromit and the stuff that Artman was doing. Even now, like with social media, stuff just spreads like wildfire because, you know, he says you want to have that thing that people look at, you know, 10 years from now and they're just like, yeah, that's what got me into it, or that's what sparked my interest. Mm-hmm. Like even, you know, with you specifically, like the reason or a part of the reason why we wanted you on, you know, in the first place, because me and my brother, just scrolling through Instagram, we saw like the Ed Balloon puppet. We were like, what is this? Like, that's so awesome.
Yeah, cool.
Like, just like, and, you know, I would go back to it and watch another one. And I'm like, okay, who is this, you know, who is this guy? Like, where did this come from? So, yeah, it was sort of a little bit of digging. And then, you know, we found Studio Linguini. And then, you know, it was just, and that's kind of how stuff happens, you know. And it's, And just to let you know, like, your work definitely made an impact on us, definitely.
Definitely.
Oh, yeah, man.
Yeah, cool.
Yeah, man. And it's just, it's awesome for me to just, you know, talk to somebody who kind of got that same background as me, because when you were talking about, like, with Legos and blocks and stuff, it took me back because I used to love to, you know, play with stuff like that. And mine was so more of, like, film than animation, because I just love how to, like, you know, aesthetically set stuff up. And I used to actually take my toys and make a set.
Yeah, cool.
And I had like a, like my Batman toys. I have a Batcave, and I had like the different Batman suits and stuff. So like my mind was already there at like 10 years old, but I had no idea this is what I'll end up, you know, kind of doing. And that's just like when you were talking about that, that's how it is for most of us people who get in that kind of like animation, film, you know, like any kind of thing like that. We don't really know that's what we're going to do until we actually get closer to it. It's something that we just always had in our life.
Right. Yeah. I mean, spot on. I think that's, and I think it takes like a little bit of formulation to realize that, you know, actually those kind of moments were fully informative. And I think probably if I was to look even further, it would reach to other sectors of my life, you know, like relationships or food things. Mm-hmm. You know, I probably, if I took the time, I could deep dive in all those things. But I think that's all, it's fascinating to see, you know, how that influences you.
Yeah, I think that like social media is a good thing, like, because I think like back in like Night Before Christmas came out, they didn't have social media, so like it wasn't like they had to do stuff through like, you know, whatever they could like bring up through just natural means. But like social media can carry things across different countries and different areas, so like I think it's like way easier for someone to get reached. Like we, you know, we found your content through social media. So like, you know, you could be reaching somebody now that you don't even know.
Well, that's it. And I think it's like 100% the case, because I follow a bunch of people and, you know, have been introduced to a bunch of people, like people in India, in Iran, in, you know, Norway, in Mexico City, and like, you know, and like, I know that there's little hubs of animation that are happening there because I follow one, and then it leads to like the model maker who does the things for that person. And then you like start seeing that the whole network is existing over there. And you're like, dang, like that's so cool. You know, who would have known that like, actually like, you know, Tehran is kicking out some sick animation, you know, some, or then like, you know, Santiago, Chile is like got a whole scene that I could like really vibe on. And you're like, you know, maybe I like we almost, my wife and I almost moved to Mexico City because we were like, we have some connections, like, you know, she's speaks Spanish and like there's a whole stop motion world that I know exists there because of social media. And I was like, well, you know, I'm connected to you, and at a certain point, like, that's a fine work connection. We've chatted, we've met in person, you know, like, what difference is that in Mexico City to like LA, you know? And so it's like, I think it really kind of bridges the gaps of places and changes the kind of conversation of what's happening, you know, where. And, you know, maybe the next time that we're chatting, like, Bucharest, Romania is like on the radar, either because like there's a whole scene of people happening there that you know, I know there is a scene of people happening in Romania that, you know, it's, I never would have thought about moving and living there, but you're like, okay, maybe Romania is the move because like animation is sick. And you're like, I would have never known, you know, that was Romania.
Yeah. No, exactly. It's just a great way to connect in general. You know, it really is. So I know we're definitely thankful for it. 100%.
Yeah. Yeah.
but yeah, Nick, it's interesting that you talked about how there's so many different stop motion scenes and different, all kinds of people all over the world that like to do the same thing. But is the process of making a stop motion puppet pretty consistent with every other region, or is it different, like the different materials and whatnot?
Good question.
That's a good question. I mean for the most part it's pretty standard. It's not so much the, like, it's like making a film, you know, where you have the camera, you have the, you know, you have the set, you have the, you know, the puppets, and I guess specifically to the puppets, like, silicone is silicone wherever it has, you know, it's probably called a different thing in different countries, and like latex and, you know, fabrics and sewing machines and all the kind of tools that you use are all the same tools. And then even, you know, like the armature, like the kind of metal skeleton that's inside this Ed balloon puppet came from Northern England. But I know that there's a company in Barcelona that makes them, and I know that there's a company in Los Angeles that makes them, and I know that people internationally are buying from those companies. So like the actual sourcing of the puppet parts is already international, because like these worlds are really, even though like there's little worlds place, like it's very small, intimate community, you know, where like people pretty much know what's happening. And so I think less than actually the puppet and the materials being different, it's more like the aesthetic kind of sensibilities that you know, may not translate in the same way. Like if you, like you can see, you know, like BoJack Horseman or like Family Guy or The Simpsons are very like LA Hollywood kind of 2D animation shows, rather than something that's like kind of like manga anime, you know, Japanese style animation, or even, you know, like there's certain kind of things that are coming out of like northern, like Chicago and things like that, or even if you like it, there's a different kind of graphic style, like, or like the Gorillas out of London, or there's like, you know, different, like, so I guess my point is that like more so it's about a communication of you know, how you actually go about it, you know. So like specifically for the puppet, like in Japan, there's a very kind of different way of understanding, you know, shapes and realness and an appreciation of it. And I think in London, there's a very kind of fine way that's either Wallace and Gromit, or it's like in like claymation kind of thing, or it's a very kind of finished commercially look. And I think in LA, there's a little bit more leeway. There's a lot of animation here that does this kind of like animated Barbie dolls and like Ken dolls and, you know, stuff that I don't really like. But then there's also like the kind of more, a bit more raw, like puppet feeling, like something like Animalisa.
Exactly, you know, so like that. Right.
Is it LA film, you know, where it's like, but to a very high extent, but it has this kind of like rawness that I think is emblematic of Los Angeles. You know, you wouldn't get a film like that made in Korea. So I think the parts are the same, but it's just the kind of way that they get shaped is would be where the, you know, where you'd have to collaborate.
Oh, the aesthetic is the
Yeah.
That's pretty cool.
Yeah. It makes it cool to communicate. Like when I was down in, you know, I went down because we were thinking about moving to Mexico City. And so I went down and met a bunch of like the animators down there. And you look at all the tools and you're like, yeah, exactly. Like, you know, I could hop in and do this shit. And people do, you know, like people travel all over the place because like, you know, it's, there's like 30, you know, top stop motion animators that go from feature film. And, you know, there's like, there's not very many of us in the world. So you move around a lot and it really kind of, you know, it translates pretty well. More so than any language that people would be speaking, you know?
No, definitely.
Yeah.
Definitely, because just like art, you know, it's, like you said, like anybody can pretty much pick it up. There's no language barrier, nothing.
Yeah, yeah.
Definitely.
And even like the skill of it, you know, even the craft, like the tools are for the most part the same, you know? Like the shoes are the same, the screw holes in the set, like the ways that all the things are made is pretty much exactly the same, you know? So it's a pretty easy, interesting little thing, I think.
So it's just mostly the way like the finished models are executed, which would kind of tell you where it comes from, kind of.
Yeah, the shapes and like what kind of like textures of the clothing and, you know, if it's got that kind of furry skin, but if you took all the exterior off of it, you know, you'd be like, okay, that's like aluminum wire welded to a K&S brass tube and then stuck on an armature joint. And the armature joint's from London and the K&S tube is from this website because I buy them from the same spots and I know how this gauge of armature wire works, you know? So you look at it and you're like, that's exactly the same as how it's made everywhere, you know, and the tools that you use to make it are all exactly the same. You know, it's just how it kind of comes together in the end, and then with the camera and the lighting and how you kind of sell the world of it is different. But like specifically the puppet is like jokingly exactly the same everywhere.
Oh, wow. You
know? It's pretty funny.
Oh. Well, if it ain't broke, don't fix it, you know? But I wanted to ask, because I kind of want to know a little bit about your education, because I think it's really interesting, because just from looking from the outside in, and I didn't really realize that until just having the conversation of how scientific it really is, because you have to know, especially because of things like Uncanny Valley, like just the way humans see humans or human-esque automatons or anything like that. You have to have the movement correct and you have to know how a human is shaped or how they walk and the walking mechanics, or it's going to be glaringly obvious. So I wanted to know, like, specifically, did you take a lot of anatomy and physiology in school or?
Like, no, but that's totally fair. I think about that a lot because it's like a really funny thing, faking human gestures in a puppet,
right. That's
you
so
know,
cool.
Like it's a really weird thing. And so like you can like the actual, you know, there's different ways of doing it. Like you can look at a reference video and then mimic it, you know, or you can kind of feel it out and give it a little bit of character and kind of find the character and the way that the puppet moves and what the kind of actual uniqueness of that puppet are or is or whatever. And I think for me, like, I think about it specifically, like it's a very math and kind of trigonometry and geometry and understanding like three-dimensional physics, you know, because like you think about how you move an arm, you know, like this, and if you move it at the regular space, it's like one movement, two movement, three movement, four movement, five movement, six movement, you know, and then it'll move at a consistent rate. But if you enlarge the first three movements and then shrink the last three movements, then you'll slow, you know, like that, or vice versa, you know, slow and then fast. And so it's really about thinking about the increment and the trajectory of the increment as to how the character will start moving, but not just of the arm, of like all the body parts, you know, like the head is moving this way. And so then when you start moving it all together, you know, and with practice, it starts becoming second nature, and you start really kind of understanding how, like, the lines of movement of, like, you know, so he's walking, and the walk cycle is simple because the hands go back and forth as the legs go straight forward. It's basically like swinging pendulums of leg and back, and then the head goes up and down kind of like hills, you know, and so you want to kind of get that regular cadence and then sync it all together. And so, you know, I think a basic understanding of kind of spatial geometry and you know, trajectories and those kind of things really helps. And that was something that I just happened to be kind of good at in school, much better than like reading comprehension or like English and stuff like that. Like it never really clicked so much. And then I think as well, like, you know, I wasn't so into anatomy, but I actually have like, for a while I was doing yoga, you know, for like 3 or 4 years, like a bunch of yoga. And I think, you know, outside of a nice healthy exercise, it was actually really informative as to how the body works in a very specific sense, you know, like how, like where your knees can bend and like where the weight is supported on certain bits, you know, and how like certain kind of gestures of where your shoulders can move and like things like that, that are what inform how, like, you know, how you move your own body, but then as well, like for an animator, how you're going to move a puppet body and just becoming like in tune with, you know, the muscle movements and what is a natural movement and what's a not natural movement. And so I think that was also, you know, informative and actually like bringing, it's called like weight to the character, you know?
Yeah.
Because you can make it move through space, but you want it to feel like it's actually abiding by the laws of gravity of the world, you know, even if it's like a more, you know, it's not the gravity that we experience on Earth, but there's actually like rules and like, you know, and that's all just kind of understanding how weight should be moving in space, outside of the actual kind of like mathematics of breaking it out, you know, if that makes sense. So for me, I think it was a combination of those two things. And then that being said, it's like, takes a lot of, attention to detail.
I bet. Yeah.
And like, yeah. And a lot of people like think that it's like, you know, they're like, oh, you do animation, you must be really patient, you know? And for me, I'm like, you know, I guess patient in the sense that it'll take a long time to finish a project, but actually like there's so much happening when you're animating that it's incredibly stimulating, you know, you're not waiting. Like if you're waiting in the DMV, you have to be patient, because otherwise you're gonna go freaking crazy and
crazy.
You know, drive yourself mad, you know? So you have to learn to not do that, you know? But when it comes to animating, like, it doesn't take so much patience because you're always doing something, you know? Like, there's a million things happening, and you're thinking about, like, the arm and the hand and the weight and the camera and the lighting and, you know, so all those things, and you're like, it all is coming together over and over and over and over and over again for hours, you know? So like you go in there and you're like, okay, that was 10 hours later, you walk out and you're like, huh, like 10 hours of time, who knew, you know? Like,
right.
But it would have felt, you know, if you were just sitting, you know, watching 3 series of some show, like it would have felt way longer because you're not actually like stimulating, you know, in the same capacity. So for me, like it's, that's also the thing where you like, it's really like, you know,
you're just like hyper focused.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. Diving into the psyche of this character, and I think that's as well kind of what you know, what makes the thing come to life, obviously.
That's really cool. Because one of the things, oh, were you about to say something, Josh?
Yeah, but
you go ahead,
finish. All right. Well, but yeah, Nick, is there any specific name for what you use to help balance the figure as you pose it?
The way that it works is like, I don't know, I don't have it. Like the way that it works is it has basically like a skeleton inside it. That's called the armature. You know, like I was saying, you know, there, it's a pretty standardized kind of thing. There's a bunch of companies that make them. Some are nicer than others, but it has like, you know, two, it's like a ball and socket joint where it's like a thing and then a clamp that is on the outside of it, that you can tighten with a Allen wrench, and that gives you like the tension. So when you're thinking about moving it, like you screw the foot into the floor, and then the ankle joint has to support a bunch of weight, so you don't want to push the puppet too far out over the ankle like you would a human, you know, otherwise you'll fall to the floor. And it's the same thing with like the knees and the hips and the elbows and all these things. So like you just get the tension right, and that supports the majority of the weight of the puppet, unless it needs to be flying and not, you know, screwed into the floor with its foot. Then you can put it on one of those stands. But mostly, yeah, it's, I mean, the thing really kind of supports itself. It's like a, you know, it's like a marionette where you move it and it'll hold, you move it and it'll hold, you move it and it'll hold. So it's just about kind of controlling those movements. Yeah.
Are they heavier towards the bottom to sort of like, I guess, keep that stability so they won't fall over, or is it all just
that's what it's nicer when they are. And like with this Ed balloon puppet, it's like very proportional where it's, you know, it's evenly weighted and it's not very heavy to begin with, so it's very easy to control. But with the bird with no legs puppets, they had really big freaking heads. So it really changed the way that you have to move them through space, because, you know, there were limitations, of course, like with the neck movement where you can't like make it go like that because the head is banging into the shoulder, you know, so then you have subtleties here. But then as well, you can't move it in the same way because it'll like tip over that way, or it'll, you know, it'll put too much pressure on the knee when you bend the knee too much, or like things like that. So it really kind of, you start understanding how the physicality of the puppet informs the way that it moves. And, you know, in actually like each of them really has like a life of its own, you know, in a weird way, because like, you know, you can make it look how you want it to look, but like for the AI puppet, for example, he's about the same size as the Ed balloon puppet, but the legs are really skinny, which means that the joints, you know, are not quite as strong in certain bits. But then as well, like there were certain bigger joints at the neck, but the way that it got tailored, you know, like I didn't realize like you couldn't turn the neck in certain ways. So like then you realize that the puppet actually has these kind of like specific characteristics that you have to fold into the character itself to not make it look weird, you know. But then it's like the character now has like a kink in its neck, so it walks in this kind of way that you make it look cool rather than like running into the problem. And then, if that makes sense.
Yeah, makes sense.
You know, yeah, it's like it just has it now has like a neck injury that is a recurring injury, you know. It's like, or one of them has like a bad knee, and then you just make it kind of walk around the bad knee, and you're like, God, he's, you know. And so it's funny because then at the end of each project, you know, you have this kind of emotional relationship with each of these puppets that each in their own right have these different characters, you know. And you're like, oh yeah, I remember my time with Ed, like, man, he was great. He was super flexible, but like his feet were a little bit stiff. You know, he wasn't the best at dancing. Mm-hmm. And like the bird with legs puppet's like, oh, they were great, but God, like, you know, weak in the stomach and like a heavy head. And like, it was such a bitch to make that guy walk, you know, that old man, you know, like, yeah. Like you start creating these like long-term relationships with these puppets. And I, you know, I think that all kind of goes to inform, you know, how you bring them to life and the way that you know them, all that kind of stuff. Mm-hmm.
Like, I can only imagine what the guys who made the original King Kong, I can only imagine what they went through. Because if you ever see, like, the original, like, one of the original, like, that.
Big, you know? I mean,
yeah, it's really big. And there's so many, like, little joints and stuff they had to use. So, like, I can only imagine.
That's ridiculous.
Yeah.
Like, one of the things specifically that's just sort of got me interested in the kind of technical wizardry and like the mechanics of how stop motion works. And I'll ask you about that in a second, because I was watching, I think it was the Box Trolls, and they had a ballroom scene, and there was like, I think like 12 or something puppets in the room all moving at the same time doing a dance. So I'm just like, that's got to be extremely hard to have to have everybody. And I know the math that has to go along with that is ridiculous. Like trying to have multiple characters in the same scene moving at the same time.
Yeah, that, I don't know exactly which scene you're talking about, but like it gets wild, you know, as you can imagine. Sometimes you can cheat it and shoot a little bit separately and then composite them together depending on how their interactions are going to go. So that is a little bit of a way of cheating it, you know, or you can have multiple animators potentially, but that's a little bit complicated, you know, working on the same scene at the same time. Or you just have, you just go really slow, you know, you just go really, really slowly. You know, like some of those shots from, Isle of Dogs, the Wes Anderson one.
Oh yeah.
You know, some of them are like big scenes and like, you know, at that point, sometimes you're getting like 1 second, you know, or 2 seconds a day.
Wow.
And that's kind of, you know, and you're really kind of working at a snail's pace because there's just so much happening that you can't go faster, you know, and have it look, you know, to the quality that they're trying to get.
Right. Yeah. So how about you? What's the most amount of characters or puppets that you've had in a singular scene at once?
I think I've done like 5, 6, something like that. Wow. Which is, you know, it's different when you, like a dancing scene, where they're all just massively moving and gesturing and you need to coordinate them.
Right.
Like, if you have a couple in the foreground and a couple in the background and then a main scene of interaction, then you can get away with much less movement, you know? So, like, there is definitely a hierarchy of difficulty, you know, or like, a sliding scale, depending on what all has to happen. Where the project that we're building now, we're gonna have like a big Braveheart battle sequence of like 15 puppets. Awesome. And I'm really excited about it. And I'm incredibly nervous about it because it'll be by far the hardest thing that, you know, I or whoever else is animating with me will have animated, because, you know, and we're kind of excited about the challenge, but like that'll exactly answer, you know, what we're talking about, I guess, is I'll be able to give you more information than how it goes.
Oh yeah, man. We can't wait to see that, man.
Yeah, I can't wait.
I know that's going to turn out great.
Yeah. It's way more fun than, you know, killing puppets. It's really like
no, exactly. That's like the way to go.
You know, it's great. But, like, again, like, are you kidding me? Two dolls, like, yeah, oh yeah, and then one. you know.
I mean, that's quite the job in general. Like, I mean, that's the thing that every guy like would love to do, just to be able to play with action figures all day.
And then you're like, you're making these like things and you're like, it's stupid. You know, it's really stupid when you're thinking about it. You're like, this is ridiculous. What am I doing? And then you're like, but it's cool. Like, and then he's going to jump up
it's
here.
Cool.
And spear slam. And you're like, you know, I'm literally a 12-year-old, but it's amazing, you know, and everything. Like, there's no, you know, I think it's pretty funny, but yeah.
That is pretty cool.
Yeah, that's pretty cool. That's really cool. But yeah, Nick, is it primarily the software that makes the armature disappear?
So like things that are outside the puppet, you mean like rigging things?
The thing that you would use to make the puppet.
Like,
well, basically the thing that you would like balance the puppet on.
It's just After Effects. So like the program itself for animating is different, and then you would like take the file that has like either has a green screen or has like these little bits, or you accidentally bump some prop, you know, like a book that's on the ground in the foreground, and you touch it and it looks like it like moves, you know, when you put all the images together.
Mm-hmm.
You take that kind of dirtier file and then you bring it into After Effects, and then you can like, you know, mask out and erase certain things and then fill in like things that you messed up essentially. And it is like a cleaning kind of tool to make it look like puppet animation, because nobody wants to see this like, you know, garbage stuff just bouncing around. So that's the thing. Like it's a pretty essential step is like the After Effects and then, you know, into the finalizing to make it look, you know, good.
Is that portion of it like less stressful than the actual animating itself, or is it kind of tedious too?
I mean, it's tedious. It's like some people really like it. It's called, you know, there's a bunch of different jobs that all kind of fit into that. It's like, you know, rotoscoping and compositing and, you know, like background painting, or like it really depends on what the thing is. But there's a whole, you know, a whole world of skills that people do, and some of them are really boring. Some of them are more monotonous. Some of them are kind of more exciting because you get to make creative decisions and, you know, and so it depends, I guess. For me, it's not as stressful because, I mean, it's only stressful when you realize that you made a mistake that you can't fix, you know, and then you have to live with it. Like, that's annoying. But, you know, other things, like, it's just a monotonous kind of thing that you have to do. You know, is my opinion. Some people really like it though.
No, definitely, understandably. One of the last things I wanted to jump into was just like, yeah, so, you know, you go to grad school, you know, you have an award-winning short film. Like, how do you get from that point to now owning like Studio Linguini? Like, how did that whole process happen? And then as far as the company specifically, like, what do you have like going on right now, or do you have any big future projects? You know, you already talked about the Braveheart-esque fight scene, you know, just a rundown of Studio Linguini. Like, how did that come to be?
Studio Linguini actually has only existed since like March. March or April is when we actually like filed the LLC paperwork. So it's like not, you know, and then even that's when we kind of moved into this space and, you know, kind of actually turned it into like a proper studio. Before that, it was basically just like me as a freelancer working with all the same people, but not actually, you know, I was working at a space of a bunch of other animators in LA. And then, you know, was just kind of under my own name rather than like a studio kind of name. And so it kind of was just a moment when obviously like the coronavirus was like happening and it was like, okay, shit. What all is the possibility of working and continuing, you know, animation and stuff. And it kind of turns out obviously that animation is very viable, you know, because you can do it pretty insularly or, you know, from England mailing things here and then me putting them together here. So it kind of worked out that we were like, okay, let's lean into it and really kind of, you know, make it a thing. And we had a couple projects lined up. And so then I kind of just partnered with a friend of mine who I've known for like 10 years and me and her, you know, just, you know, the producer woman who I mentioned earlier, just decided that it was like a good moment. She'd gotten laid off of her job. But was like getting unemployment. And so it was like, now I'm down to start it up, you know, whatever, 5 months ago, 4 months ago. So then we just did, and we kind of hit the ground running pretty hard. And since then, you know, it's been kind of nonstop. We've added projects, you know, and have kind of kept the wheels going pretty heavily. And I guess, so some of those probably like majority music videos that we have that we're working on right now, that's kind of where our so far bread and butter is. We have like two music videos that are puppets, you know, that are not related to Ghost Main.
And now a word from our sponsors. The Square Roundtable podcast is brought to you by Two Photon Art. Two Photon is an art collective whose primary mission is to make science more accessible through science communication and art. Some of their art includes science-themed patches, jewelry, stickers, zines, and clothing, all of which contribute to the inclusivity, equality, and the overall advocacy for human rights in and out of the scientific community. You can find all of these wonderful pieces on twofotonart.com. And for all our YouTube viewers out there, we will add all of their website and social media info in the description below. Hey, all you freaks and geeks out there. We are the Square Round Table. The Square Round Table podcast is brought to you by Science on a Postcard. Science on a Postcard is an online store that specializes in science-themed enamel badges, lanyards, environmentally friendly tote bags, notebooks, and lots more goodies that represent individuality and inclusivity in the scientific community. You could find all these wonderful products on scienceonapostcard.com. And for all our YouTube watchers out there, we will add their website and all their social media platforms in the description
below. So we're doing that, which is like a short film project. And then as well, I have another short film that's a kind of CG live action combination.
Awesome.
That I'm working on. Yeah, so I guess, you know, two short films and then a bunch of music videos. And then we're trying to... We're in talks with a couple other larger music video projects that we're trying to land and kind of get. So, we're trying to expand, but we're also, you know, almost at capacity right now.
Yeah, well that's great. I didn't even realize that you guys really just started up. Like,
we're babies.
That's awesome, man.
Yeah, y'all hit the ground running, though.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah, thanks.
Speaking of, like, just starting and being brick and mortar and whatnot, what are some of the essentials that someone that wants to get into stop motion need?
I think, like, to actually, like, do the animation.
Yeah.
Like, a camera or a phone with a camera is kind of, like, in a tripod. Are kind of like the things, and then probably Dragon Frame is like the best program. There's a couple other programs that I haven't used, like iStopMotion. I think iStopMotion is like $100 and Dragon Frame is like $200, something like that. And beyond that, like, it's kind of all you need, you know. You don't even really need the program if you wanted to. You know, like, if you imagine, like, you take your, I don't know if you guys have iPhones or Android phones or whatnot, but at least on the iPhone, there's like the time lapse feature. You know what I mean?
Yeah, I know exactly what you're talking
about. Yeah, and so, like, presumably on every phone, you just hit the time lapse feature, and it'll take photo, right, in time. But if you imagine, like, I set my phone up over there, and then photo, a second later, I make a move, like, that's a stop motion, you know what I mean? And it'll look like I'm just, like, floating across the screen, if that makes sense.
Oh,
you
know? No.
Or, like, you can just set up your phone here, and then, like, move a pencil across the table, you know, according to, like, how the time-lapse goes, and, like, that's a stop motion, you know? And it'll look like the pencil is, like, sliding on its own across the table. So that's really all you need to make stop motion, you know? And then, like, the kind of, like, a time lapse is essentially a stop motion, but you're just not controlling it, you know. So that's kind of all you need, I guess.
Right. So basically, yeah. So it's kind of like a little, like, a do-it-yourselfer thing. Like, all you really need is the basic level of it. For anybody out there that wants to get into stop motion, all you need is an iPhone and time lapse, basically, and an imagination.
And a dream.
definitely imagination and a dream. And I would say probably it'll help to have Dragon Frame or something like that and plug it into your computer and see what you're doing, you know. But yeah, it's pretty easy barrier to entry, you know. And then obviously, like, from there it goes. But that's how I started. I just bought the program, they sent it to me in the mail, and I was like, I don't know what the fuck to do with this thing. looked at it on YouTube, you know, and I was like, okay, I guess that's how you, like, open the window, that's how you start the new take, that's how you, like, you know, that's how you move it. Like, and I literally just taught myself the program. It's a very simple program. And then you figure out how you can plug your camera into your computer. And then, like, you're seeing what your camera's seeing. And then you basically just, like, move whatever's in front of it. And it's, you know, you make a movie. And so
it's stop motion, just like that.
Exactly. It's not very hard.
That.
Yeah.
That's awesome. Well, Nick, like, we think what you're doing is amazing. Like, I can... You know, I can speak for myself, but I know everybody here, especially like me and my brother, like we've been huge like advocates for art, and just stop animation has always had like a special place in my heart, because ever since I was a little kid, I just thought it was so amazing. So to be able to sit here and, you know, talk to someone that is prominent in creating that art form is just the best. It's awesome, man. I'm so glad that we had a chance to talk to you today.
Yeah, yeah, no, it was awesome. Yeah, definitely. Yeah, thank you.
I learned so much today.
Yeah, kind of. A little bit. It was so boring, you know? Boring. Like, I didn't talk about all the YouTube other stuff, so hopefully it's not boring.
No, it wasn't boring at all. I enjoyed it.
Very informative. I was going to say, I was all in it, man.
Very informative. But yeah, Nick, definitely. Everybody on power214.com and everybody watching on YouTube, definitely tell them your social media information, where they can find you, all of that good stuff.
Yeah, yeah. It's, I mean, it's just at Studio Linguini, Studio _ Linguini, and Linguini with an I for some reason. and that's kind of the thing. We have a Twitter, but we don't really use it. I mean, mostly it's just, it's Instagram is kind of the bread and butter. And then as well, like, yeah, www.studiolinguini.com. But yeah, that's _Linguini on Instagram is where most of our stuff kind of goes.
Cool. All right. Definitely. So that's wonderful so far. Yeah. All of our YouTubers out there, we'll definitely put all of Nick's information in the description below. And like every time, it is time for my shameless promotion. So yeah. You can catch the Square Roundtable podcast on power214.com every Friday at 10 a.m. Pacific time, 12 p.m. Central time, and 1 p.m. Eastern time.
Go ahead, and you can catch us on YouTube on Friday right after the video comes out at any time. And if you like it, like it, subscribe, and hit the notification bell, and also leave us a comment, because we like to read those.
Definitely, definitely. And one more time, everybody, including our wonderful guest for today, introduce yourselves. My name is Chad Singleton.
D.
Josh Singleton.
Mark and Mark.
And I'm Nick Cinelli, Studio Linguini. Awesome.
And this has been the Square Roundtable. We are out.
Yeah. Peace.